Hello, everyone. I'm Linda Ayers. Welcome to Tuesday Talks, brought to you by Cleveland Park Main Street, Woodley Park Main Street, the Cleveland and Woodley Park Village, and the DC Public Library. You can join in tonight's conversation by posting comments or questions at any time during tonight's talk using the Q&A or chat function on your screen. You'll need to open up your YouTube or Google account to do this, or you can email directly to clevelandparklibrary@dc.gov. Marissa Bateman from the library will moderate a Q&A with our speaker following tonight's presentation. And tonight's topic is changes in journalism over a lifetime in the news, and features Terence Samuel, managing editor of National Public Radio. Terry has a crazy busy job of the daily oversight of the news gathering operation at NPR, and he's had an illustrious career. From 2011 to 2017, he was politics editor at the Washington Post, overseeing both White House and congressional coverage. And before that, he was congressional managing editor at the National Journal. He started his career as a writing fellow at the Village Voice in New York, and later was a reporter at the Roanoke Times and World News, then a national correspondent at the Philadelphia Inquirer and the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, and chief congressional correspondent at U.S. News and World Report. Terry was director of editorial programming for AOL Black Voices before joining the Post Company in 2007 to help launch TheRoot.com. Terry is a graduate of the City College of New York and the author of a 2010 book, The Upper House, A Journey Behind the Closed Doors of the U.S. Senate. He lives in Woodley Park. Terry, we're so grateful to you for being here. Welcome.
Thank you so much. And thanks to everyone who is out here listening this evening. I have to say I am more than simply honored to be here. I am really grateful, and I have to admit, just a little bit intimidated, even though I've done lots of these. There's something about Cleveland Park and the association with the listserv that makes me nervous, because that is an intimidating place, as you all know. But thank you all again for being here this evening. These conversations I gather are always the idea being to get some sage person to come talk about big changes happening in the world. And I feel like I bring something else to this. I think in some ways I have landed in a place where I feel in some ways very naive, both about journalism and about politics in America today, in that I find myself remarkably hopeful about the future of both. And I venture to say that is not a common feeling in general today. When we talk about changes in journalism over a lifetime, and by the way, I have a 20-year-old who asked why I was doing this speech, and I told her what the title was, and she was like, "Oh, you're doing this because you're old." That, I have to say, is kind of the essential truth of the whole thing. When we talk about changes in journalism over my career anyway, I think we're talking a lot about three things these days. We're talking about social media and the internet. We're talking about partisanship and kind of the political dystopia that we find ourselves in. The third thing being a lot of concern and worry about whether journalism will survive in any reasonable fashion going forward. I think the answer to all of this is yes, in my view. But it is a very stressful time and a very difficult conversation to have about what is happening in journalism and in our politics in recent years. In a lot of ways, my my career, my 35 plus years in this business kind of reflects much of the changes that that we're talking about and worrying about. As you heard, my first writing job was at the Village Voice, and that publication struggled, went out of business, came back, and we'll see what happens going forward. At The Voice, I literally wrote my first stories on a typewriter, a big heavy one that was too heavy to throw. And that was important because people did throw typewriters at The Village Voice. But also it was, talk about page views. My biggest concern and my biggest moment in those early days was sitting on the Lexington Avenue local and seeing somebody actually reading the story that I'd written in the Village Voice while I had $284 check in my pocket, which was the first paycheck I ever got for writing anything. That was my idea of what a page view was. And now obviously we're talking about something completely different and something that controls our lives in a very different way. After The Voice, I did a thing that looks a lot like, everything that follows looks a lot like what happened to journalism. I worked for a small regional daily, then I worked for a big metro daily, and then I went to another big metro daily, then I went to a magazine, a weekly that we thought with, back in the days, that was an elevation because you got to write more and it was once a week and it was more thoughtful and less of a grind. I went to a little media startup called AOL. It was a media startup, but a big tech firm, and we couldn't figure out what to do with either one. After that, I foolishly wrote a book, assuming that people still read. Apparently they did, but not that one in particular. That turned out to be a great adventure. And then a string of things that essentially look like the digital age that we're living in now. The root.com was a startup aimed at a very specific audience. African-American readers, started by the Washington Post because they were chasing a different audience. That was a very new thing and a new idea that you could just go off and do something, not just build on the one you have, but start a new thing so that you can serve a different audience, which frankly is pretty much all we do now. After The Root, I went to National Journal, which was essentially a subscription a subscription publication, not funded by as much advertising as all the dailies that I had worked for. And so you could see the business model starting to shift in those early years. Then the Washington Post. A big national daily that when I got there was in trouble. People were getting laid off every year. It was part of the process that budgeting meant layoffs. And then, as you all know, something remarkable happened. And a guy named Jeff Bezos bought it and saved not just the Post, but in some ways, some people think, save journalism. And now I work for public media, and that is funded by, as we like to say, listeners like you. And what are we doing now? We are essentially trying to get people to pay for the news by subscribing or donating to their local stations, as opposed to buying a newspaper. Newspapers are, in the same fashion, trying to build subscription, digital subscriptions, because nobody's picking the newspaper up off their stoop anymore, except probably me. So where do we start? What's changed? Let's talk a little bit about the social media issue. We live and die by the people who come to our websites and don't. And as a result, you see local newspapers dying because there's not enough advertising to support that journalism. There are not enough people willing to pay for that journalism to support it. And what you have is kind of a vanishing of really essential work happening at the local level. It extends to what's happening in state houses. And essentially you have basically nobody covering the government except a few big national publications that cover the very end of the process, people in Congress, people in the White House, and that feels very, very distant from people's everyday lives, because nobody's covering the city council, nobody's covering the school board, and as a result, there is less and less participation in those things. People don't even know where the power in their government is, or that they have any. They just don't understand. And so we have a situation where there's like this huge partisan divide that we worry about and talk about so much is driven by this idea that we're not talking to each other. We're not even arguing. I mean, arguments are, you know, premised on the idea that there are different interpretations of a established set of facts. Well, there's no established set of facts. I mean, I guess it was Patrick Moynihan who first said that, you know, you're entitled to your own opinion, but you're not entitled to your own facts. Well, we live in a time where people feel very entitled to their facts and conduct in their entire lives, socially, politically, social media, on the social media front, absolutely with their own set of facts. And so there's absolutely no conversation. We in journalism are trapped in a strange situation in which we continue to do great work, some of us, but what are we competing with? We're competing with everybody who has a phone or a social media account, because the great big investigations about the government or your city council, all the great work is mostly showing up on somebody's phone in their Facebook feed, in their Twitter feed. I think the last number I saw is that 48% of Americans get their news from social media. So the good news about that is there's a lot of social media, and so there's a lot of news. However, it is difficult to know what's important and what's not, because those big investigations I'm talking about are showing up right next to, you know, before and after pictures of celebrities from the 1990s, or your cousin's son's wedding from Curacao, or somebody's recipe. And it's impossible to decide what's important and what's not. And that's what we're competing with. We have lost, we in the media, in some ways have lost the gatekeeping function that we once prized and maybe didn't use wisely enough. But here we are. We have to compete with, you know, the recipes, and we have to depend on Facebook and Google to drive traffic. And it is a difficult place to be, because there's kind of I mean, when you got on the front page of the newspaper, or when you read the front page of the newspaper, you had a sense that somebody had made a decision that this was a priority and it was important. And that was the way to go. Now, there is none of that. In addition to all the harmless, innocuous, fun stuff, the internet is just full of misinformation, and it has become at least as big a problem trying to deliver accurate, fair, useful news or journalism as it is trying to combat the misinformation that that is just afloat in the atmosphere. And it's impossible to overstate how much work that is and how much a part of our daily lives that has become. You know, when I got into this business, and maybe long before that, there was a saying, if your mother told you she loved you, check it out. Well, now it's, well, define love. And it's impossible to get anybody to agree on anything. And people are increasingly just, as I said, not talking to each other. Which I think forces us, people who are trying to do this in some kind of responsible way, to deal with some very difficult things. One, the audience question. There's a big conversation in journalism about audience growth and how you do it. And what you find is there's a lot of talk about finding the right audience for your publication and building on that and leaving everything else to somebody else, which is a great idea for a lot of people. But the business of kind of conducting a national conversation that helps to move the democracy forward is lost in that equation. You find yourself in many ways doing what almost micro-targeting, like as if you're a political party. And that's a very difficult thing, but you see it day in and day out. Every time you turn around, there's a new publication aimed at X group or Y group. You see popular writers leaving to go start their own publications because there's an audience that wants to hear from them and them alone, because they're getting what they're paying for. And it is a very specific, very self-selecting set of information. And I think generally that has been bad for the conversation. But what to do about it? In some ways, I don't think the answer is that difficult. If I could just deal firstly with the misinformation part of the problem. I mean, there's just so much of it that you can't stop paying attention to it. And as a result, it takes away time, resources, and attention from like the real work. And it's an impossible task for me every day trying to figure out how much time to spend debunking stuff. The popular phrase is Twitter is reporting. And what do you do with that? You can't just ignore it. So you spend time on it and take time away from actual real work. The real work, in my view, is basically doubling down on fact-based, reliable reporting that that comes with a really high bar of integrity. There's obviously huge discussions about what is fair and what is objective, and whether journalists can set aside their biases, and whether that's an old-fashioned notion. I'm not sure that there was ever any real objectivity, but there was, I think, and there continues to be, a real effort to be fair and thorough and to pursue the truth. And when you're doing that, you don't have to worry that much about objectivity, because the truths will often land you on one side of the line or the other. And it's not that important to be objective going in, but it is incredibly important to understand your own biases and how to deal with them. And I think it's been my experience that my generation of journalists understood how to do that. And if you want to know one of the reasons I'm hopeful, I think I see a whole new crop of young people who want to do this work and want to do it in an engaged, forceful way, but also want to be just absolutely fierce in search of the truth. It's especially about things they care about. So they care about climate, and they care about race and gender and what's fair and how to be inclusive. And they work really hard at it, and they are completely open to the idea that the way to do this is to set aside their biases and keep working. All right, let me talk a little bit about what the title of this talk did not talk about, which is not what's changed so much in over my lifetime, but what I hope will change down the road. All the bad news about social media and the internet has also been an amazing boost for a kind of journalism that didn't exist before. There are now more people and more voices being heard than was ever possible. And that's a good thing. I think the loss of control that I talk about, the kind of end of the gatekeeping function, has meant that other people have joined the conversation. And that has, I think, has been an enormously good thing. Because quite frankly, we didn't always use this thing correctly. You know the history of women in American newsrooms, the history of Black people and other people of color, difficult times. I saw a report today that that the University of Maryland will begin a study of how newspapers in the late 1800s and for much of the early 20th century supported and encouraged lynching. And there are multiple sins that that the media was responsible for that I think have gone away and that we should be happy to see go. More than one newspaper has publicly apologized for the way they covered African Americans in their previous incarnations, the paper's previous incarnations. So I think all of that is good. I think we now have a very different conversation happening, and I think much of what much of what I feel hopeful about is that the conversation is better, there are more people involved, and the kind of high and mighty, we don't really care what you think approach to journalism is, I think, gone and probably dead forever. There was it's interesting to listen to the kind of depth of concern from media executives about audience and serving them and making sure they, you quote, meet them where they are, meaning their phones, quite frankly, is what people are talking about. Because that wasn't always the case. There was a famous state editor at the Philadelphia Inquirer when I worked there, and people would call up and complain about something in the paper, and whether you worked on the state desk or not, you would send whoever was complaining to this guy, because his basic response was, whoever you are, it was usually something more vulgar than that. We don't need you. Cancel your subscription. Because it was dominance in a way that that made us feel invincible, and that's gone forever. Now we are desperate for people to subscribe. We're desperate for them to sign up for newsletters, because those newsletters would be tailored exactly to what they say they need. And I think increasingly that's where this business is going, with the reader and the listener and however the audience composes itself, decides that that they will be at the center of all of these equations and all of this discussion. And that's, I think, the way people see going forward that kind of journalism writ large will survive. And two, it is, I think, the only way to rebuild the trust that has been so badly damaged over recent years for all kinds of reasons. I mean, the other reason I am generally hopeful is that what we do is essential, and it keeps finding ways to reinvent its relevance, if you will. The pandemic did huge damage to the economy, but if you were at NPR during the early days of the pandemic, where a massive amount of our audience listened to us in cars on commutes to and from work, and suddenly everybody was at home, and the numbers did one of these things that, people were walking around with like their hearts in their throat for weeks at a time. But then what happened? After a while, one, eventually they started to come back. But two, before that happened, people started listening to the shows, the radio, so to speak, on their smart speakers, listening on kind of Alexa and all the other ones, went from an average of like 45 minutes a day to 7 and 8 hours a day. And so people keep finding ways to get what it is that they need. And I think what it is that they need, that's so essential, both not just for the journalism or for the kind of the future of the republic, so to speak, but it's this very human need for storytelling and sharing and kind of knowing and understanding the world around you. When there was, so that the pandemic brought a lot of people to us in a different way than they had been. But during the huge kind of crazy Trump years, when much of what the president did was fight with kind of traditional journalism and traditional news outlets, you saw people just flood to kind of these places that they regarded as reliable and consistent And you saw just huge spikes in subscriptions, traffic, consumption all across the board. Now, I think some of that's disappeared, and I think people were just exhausted, and I completely get that. But I think what we do is completely and eternally essential, and it is up to us to find ways to do as much as we can to preserve it and reinvent it and make it new for people who come after us. And I think I will stop there and talk more in the question portion of this.
Great. Thank you so much, Terry. I really appreciate that. That was a great talk. So please, everyone, if you have any questions for Terry, please leave them in the chat. And you can do that by logging into your Google or YouTube account. And you can leave that in the chat function on YouTube. Or you can email clevelandparklibrary@dc.gov. And I am monitoring. I am looking at that, making sure that I can see all of your emails. So please let us know. I do have a couple of people that gave us some questions ahead of time. So I will ask those questions. So kind of something that we haven't gotten from you was, could you describe your average day at NPR? And I'm adding on, how does that compare to other news organizations that you've worked for in the past?
My average day at NPR, I wish I could say there was one. So, you know, we have this early show called Morning Edition that goes on the air at 5 a.m. And the most recent wrinkle in that show is that the first 20 minutes is basically the dry run of what becomes the Up First podcast, which is very popular, and we think a real agenda setter for listeners everywhere, and it gets millions and millions of downloads every day. So we start worrying, and that's mostly what I do. I worry and try to keep other people from worrying. I wake up at, depending on the day, around 5. I mostly try to hear that first part of the show live. I spend a few minutes reading notes from people who worked overnight to see what is happening, what is going to happen, what got done, what didn't get done. Then we're there are a bunch of conversations, usually now by Slack or email, about the show on the air, reporting that's missing. This morning it was a 4 o'clock and North Korea had launched a missile. We had it in the newscast at 5 o'clock. The question was there a bigger conversation to have about it in Morning Edition itself? We decided yes. I got on the phone to Anthony Kuhn in Seoul. We talked, we figured out we could do it in about, I didn't figure this out. The people doing the show figured it out. They could do this in about 3 minutes and 45 seconds. He wrote the script, I edited it. It was 6 o'clock. It was on at 6:30. Questions about what else is going on in the world, what's going on with these. So this morning we were worried, I was worried about the Texas, the Justice Department's brief on the Texas abortion law. I was worried about Haiti. All of this gets hashed out in an 8 o'clock meeting where the entire network which is strangely built. There are the shows, Morning Edition, All Things Considered, a midday show we do out of Boston called Here and Now. So they are all trying to figure out how to program their shows and what they need to do and what it is they can get away with not doing. Is there somebody who can help? Tonight there was a meeting at the White House between Biden and some Democratic lawmakers, two different versions of Democratic lawmakers. ATC, All Things Considered, was on at 4 o'clock. And the question was, if there's any news, will there be somebody who can come on and update? And I don't know what the outcome of that was. But so at 8 o'clock, we sit around and talk a lot about what we're gonna do that day, what the show's gonna look like that afternoon, what we're looking at in terms of tomorrow morning, what reporting we're gonna do that's gonna be just on npr.org and not on any of the shows. And then it's a lot of questions about little things that add up. I have a story about military mental health and the lack of it. I have two people, a husband and wife. They are very concerned about the husband's suicidal episodes. Can we use that conversation with them without using their names? Because, well, for obvious reasons. Yes, we can, but we have to make that decision every time. So there's a lot of that. And then we just, again, start planning for the next day and a lot of trying to figure out what the big stories are and how we should approach them. There's a huge debate tonight about whether the Brazilian legislature deciding that to call for the indictment of Jair Bolsonaro was big news or not, given that nothing will likely happen. I thought it was, some people thought it wasn't. Where we ended up was, it was news, but it was news with all the caveats that people were concerned about. So it's long, it's like they're long days, but they're fun, is the answer.
That's great. So actually, that kind of goes into my next question. You mentioned the change in use of listening during the pandemic specifically, and adapting to kind of how people are using the service. And I was wondering, do you think that adapting is the job of the media service or the customer or both? And I was thinking specifically, how many amazing podcasts that NPR have brought online in the past few years, especially Up First, which was one of my favorites, and WAMU had the big listen and a few others, and also with the development of the app, which has changed drastically over the last few years. And is it kind of like a supply driving demand or vice versa?
Look, the bottom line is we can't do anything. I mean, all the great stuff we do, if nobody's listening to it, if nobody's reading it, it's useless. And I don't think the audience is adapting. I think the audience is the audience. It's changing. It's, for people who never ever saw a newspaper delivered to their house, they get their stuff on their phone and they listen. And so we have to go where they are. And that means, in addition to, I think, just absolutely dogged, constantly reporting the way we always have, we have to go meet them on their phones. We have to go meet them on social. We have to go meet them on video and you know. So yes, I think we have to adapt or evolve, however you'd like to think of it. And it's an everyday problem. I mean, the audience is just, I mean, in some ways savvier. I mean, they just don't need the same things from us that they once did. There's just a lot of information. They don't need us to tell them what the, they don't need NPR, for example, to tell them what the weather is. And so we don't. Actually, we do a lot in the local forecast, but people want things that they don't know, and they want a lot of context, and they want to know what things mean. And mm-hmm. I think the more time we spend doing that and explaining, the better we do.
Absolutely. So I have a question from the audience. I'll put it on the screen. When you say that you follow the big stories, is it just trying to be first or trying to follow slower moving stories that require more context and information, for example, climate change?
Look, I always want to be first. But I will say that is not the thing that drives the current newsroom that I'm in. And sometimes it's maddening, but it's true. It is not the biggest thing for us. I would say the biggest thing for us, the thing that obsesses everyone across the board, is making sure you get it right and that you are on the right story. And the first one is a lot easier because we've been doing it for a long time. The second one's a lot harder because that is constantly changing. But, you know, on climate change, for example, you know, we could tell, and we have, we've told hundreds and hundreds of stories. We've done stories about flooding in urban areas, you know, flooding in Baltimore and Houston, and what causes that. And occasionally you just have to stop and go, what is going on here? What do we need to tell people? And I think what we need to tell people right now is, as we go into this this COP20, this climate summit in Glasgow, is that, you know, we've been trying this for a long time and often failing politically, and the question is why, and whether that's going to happen again this time, and we'll see. I feel like that's the right story, but we'll see what happens tomorrow.
Fair enough. So another question I have from David, does print journalism, especially newspapers, publish more analysis and less hard news than when you began your career?
I would say, based on the framing of that question, I think there is more analysis and less hard news. But I think, again, I think there is this sense that, you know, we used to tell you what was on the school lunch menu. We used to tell you what was, look, the papers are different. I mean, they don't even tell you what's on sale anymore because nobody's buying it. I mean, the audience is just different. And so I think people who are still consuming newspapers are looking for kind of a more in-depth look at the world. They kind of know the X's and O's, and so I think, yes, there is more analysis. And the place where there is more hard news is the place where we can make a difference are investigations and, you know, really hard, rigorous, accountable journalism, which the audience can't do for itself.
So I kind of had a question based on your talk. You know, you talked about how more voices are being heard, and there's kind of been a loss of gatekeeping, which has been a good thing. Do you think that NPR is doing a good job of making sure that many voices are being heard? And can you talk about how that you're doing a good job at that?
I think we are doing a good job. I think certainly doing a better job than we did. And I think the biggest reason is that we recognize that it's a problem and that we had a problem, and that we just have to try more. So I'm constantly pushing people to do stories that are not based in Washington or New York or Los Angeles. We have a really good system of bureau chiefs and member stations. And so you will get a lot of Nashville and Boise and Seattle and you name it. Just because, and tomorrow Maine on EMTs who won't get vaccinated. So there's that, but there's also the question, and we have now begun tracking the number of, tracking the diversity of sources on our programs. So we now know how many women, we now know how many African-Americans or whatever it is. We have a tracker for sources that give us a sense of how we're doing. And the answer is we're doing better, but we were starting from a pretty bad place. So, yes.
Well, on a lighter note, I'll have to say that, you know, I'm a big fan of NPR, and I laugh because anytime someone says like a certain city or a certain name, I kind of hear it in my head. So, you know, I always say Dakar when anything's happening out of Africa.
Yes, that is a legendary one.
So talk about a legend.
we now have the other obvious one that everybody likes to talk about is Lakshmi Singh, who is legendary and lives in, you know, Maryland, not in Dakar, or Ader Peralta in Nairobi. It's funny to hear all those voices, and those people are really terrific professionals, and it shows.
Absolutely. And I mean, obviously this is just my opinion, but I'm a daily listener, and I think, you know, you're doing a good job. So
we want more of you.
Yes. I'm a fan. So let's see if, we have another question from the audience. So we have a question. Is reporting at NPR in any way different by virtue of being public?
I think the reporting is not different, but there is this line in like all the NPR communications that says a mission-driven organization. And look, I worked in commercial journalism for much of my time, and you know, a lot of those were nonprofits were de facto nonprofits. There is a sense here that we have a kind of different level of responsibility to the public, and not that we don't have to make money, but that is not a big part of the equation, because we kind of know where the money's coming from. We do work. We deliver it to people, and we ask them to pay for it voluntarily, and they do. And you know, you say you love NPR. There's a joke that says love is not a business strategy, but in some ways, in this place, it is. So I don't think the reporting itself is different, but I think the people doing the reporting approach it in there's a responsibility to the public end of the process that I think is special here.
Sure. And I mean I might be projecting as a public library employee, but do you consider it more as a service rather than a business?
Oh, it's absolutely a service. And we feel that, I think, more and more as you know, local newspapers have disappeared, as you know, kind of the big outlets, particularly broadcast outlets, have kind of chosen to segment themselves by audience, right, left, whatever. We feel kind of a special responsibility to try to play it straight and give people what they want. And when I say play it straight, I mean, part of how we do that is that we just don't do politics, right? Just to go back to the last question for a second, here's how it is different. There is a line in the NPR mission statement that says, we seek to serve the whole person. And so, yeah, we are going to tell you what the news is, but we're going to try to entertain you and be distracting and entertaining. And so you come back every day.
And I do have another question, but I just wanted to say that, you know, you were talking about how the news is competing, especially on social media, with all types of different information and misinformation, and, you know, with the recipes and celebrity news and, you know, your family news and all of these things. But I think you're right. I mean, NPR does do human interest. They do recipes, you know, they do authors and music and all of those things that do keep us interested.
We do a lot of music. That may save us at the end of the day. Because if you look at the audiences, you know, for the magazine shows, let's just say the average is close to my age. And for the music and podcast shows, the average age is about half my age. So that we think is our future.
So I have another question. I think we have a time for the last question from the audience. So, you know, we're talking about local news, and you were saying about that as well in your talk. And the question is, do you think that local NPR stations are doing a good job covering local news?
Some of them are, and some of them are strapped, suffering in some ways the same fate as the local newspapers. But I think more and more a lot of member stations see an opportunity to fill a void that has vanished because of whatever has happened in local reporting. And I mean, the most obvious and recent example is WBEZ in Chicago in talks with the Chicago Sun-Times to merge those two news outlets, which is kind of an amazing thing because, you know, for so long, the public radio station was the one strapped and begging for money and in need of salvation. And now it looks like that merger may save what is obviously a legendary American newspaper, which Chicago terribly, terribly needs.
Thank you. Is there anything else that you wanted to share with us or say before we wrap up for the evening?
Oh, no, just thank you for having me.
Thank you. This is great. I really enjoyed hearing you speak, and thank you. This has been great. All right, great. So I hope that you're not terribly afraid of the listserv anymore.
I was never afraid of it, but it is a little intimidating.
Yeah, I understand. I've gotten a couple of posts where I've gotten corrected too with my grammar. So I understand.
I'll be ready.
All right. So I'll bring back Linda in, and thank you everyone for joining us this evening. And we will see you next month. And Linda will be telling us more about that.
Thanks so much, Terry. As another daily listener of NPR, we thank you for everything that you do. And it was great to get your insights tonight, and also really heartfelt to hear your optimism about the future of journalism in America. Thanks to Marissa, and she had a great conversation with you. And we always thank our audience for joining us. We hope you'll be back on November 16th when constitutional scholar Jeffrey Rosen, author of Conversations with RBG, will discuss the future of the Supreme Court. Until then, thank you and be well. Good night.